celebrating that it is back to school time. It is a different time. It is a unique back to school setting. But we want you to know at Mt.Airy that we love you and that you can be successful in school. So here's what we want to do, all right? We want to see any school-age children, any school-age all the way through high school, even if you're college, if you're comfortable, will you step out of your vehicle and get to the front of the vehicle and let us see you, all right? So if you're going to school, if you're comfortable, if you'll stand up right there where you're at, maybe step outside of your car, and then let us see. I see little man over here to my right stepping out. I see Chloe and them right here on the front. I see some over here on this side. I see some over here on this side. We thank you for coming to church today, and we want you to know that we love you and we're excited about you getting ready to go back to school. And at the end of service today, we have a gift for you, a back to school gift. And I see Miss D on my left side. And Miss D, is this where you're going to give it out at? Okay. Before you leave today, those of you going to school, you might want to wait because of the way we're parking and everything like that. You might want to just be patient at the end and let everybody kind of leave out, because you're going to have to make your way this way to the trailer over here. We got a gift for you. We'll make sure all school age, that's first grade through sixth grade, that's your ages. Now, we'll get you high school and college later, but first grade through sixth grade, we got a gift for you over here with Miss D to my left at the trailer. And since that's in the corner, you're probably going to have to just be where you're at and wait and let everybody leave, and then you'll make your way over here to Miss D. We'll work it out at the end, all right? We got a gift for you. So thank you, school age. You can go back and sit in your vehicle now if you want to. We love you, and we're celebrating back to school today. It's going to be a great year, all right? We'll start our service with a quick prayer. If you'll bow your heads, we'll pray. Dear Lord, thank you for our service today, the beginning of our service, Lord. We ask that you will anoint this service. Touch us today, Lord Jesus Christ, that in a unique way, in a different way, in an abnormal way that we're not used to necessarily being, God, that we'll still open our hearts and our minds, we'll still have clarity and be prepared. We're getting ready to worship now, Holy Father. Let us worship right here where we're sitting at, Lord. Let us enjoy a connection with you in our vehicle, Holy Father, sitting in our lounge chairs, Lord. The pastor's going to preach. As the pastor preaches, Lord, we ask that we open our hearts and minds to accept your message and just guide us today, Lord, because you are a good God. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome. Isn't this breeze wonderful? It feels so good. All right, we are so thankful to be here. And just as the pastor said, this is our back-to-school Sunday. We're excited for our kids, our young adults, and our teachers. But we also know that it's a different time. It is. But it's still an exciting time. And I want to remind you that there's a song we used to sing when we were kids, and it's still true today. Do you remember the song, "He's Got the Whole World in His Hands"? That song is true no matter what age you are. He's always got us in his hands. And there's some scripture that's related to that song, and it's relating to God's promise to our security. We always can be secure in his promise. In John 10, 27 through 29, it says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life. They shall never perish. My Father, which gave them me, Jesus, is greater than all. No man is able to pluck them from my hand, my Father's hand." So I want to be reminded that our God is holding us in the palm of his hand. Yeah. And we're going to have a wonderful school year, kids and teachers. So will you sing with me as we sing, "He's Got the Whole World in His Hands"? I know you know it. Sing with us.
Wind and the rain in his hands.
the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. Yes, he's got everybody here in his hands. He's got everybody here in his hands. Everybody here in his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands. Yes, he's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world.
We also are very appreciative of those who have in the past given their hearts and times and love to the educational system. Mt.Airy is a church that is full of educators, retired educators that went back to work somehow in some version, that volunteered to go into the school. And obviously we have educators now. We got from principals to teacher assistants. Your job and your role is extremely important in our school system. What a ministry it is if God has called you to dedicate yourself to work with the children of the community, because you and I know that there are children that are in tough situations, that do not have optimal situations at home. But get excited about going to school to see that teacher assistant who just loves them, to go to the library and hear Ms. Hammonds read them a book. And even to go to the cafeteria with our cafeteria workers to get breakfast and lunch, you are a vital role in the school system, and we want you to be safe. If you are a if you work in a school and you're comfortable to stand outside of your vehicle, will you step outside of your vehicle as we get ready to pray? So if you work at a school, if you're a principal, teacher assistant, you work in the cafeteria, I see Ms. Lori over there to my left, I see Brother Spencer getting out of his truck. There's Miss Hammonds right there in the library. I see a few more on this side working in the school system. So we are very appreciative of you and all the extra time and effort that you put in the school system. And we love you. And we are praying for your safety also. We're praying that decisions will be made. I see Miss Shelley over here to my left. That decisions will be made to be very protectful for you also in that school system. Brother Billy's to my right over there. So we love you also, and we are praying for you too. This is also our prayer while our teachers and our principals are standing outside of their vehicles. This is also our prayer that we want to remember those who are having a hard time and those prayer requests that are on your hearts. If you have an unspoken request, will you raise your hand, lift your hand, or you can blow that horn if you want to blow that horn. Amen. The Lord knows that, knows what that request is. Pastor Kelvin told me that he had a wonderful experience with Brother Kent, who is Brother Earl's son. Kent gave his heart to the Lord and is saved now. Give him a celebration for that. Amen. The pastor got to go there and celebrate that joyous time. And listen, the Lord is still working. There's no social distancing when it comes to getting saved. There's no social distancing when it comes to the Holy Spirit doing great things. So we're excited about a new brother in life for sure. We want to pray for Brother Monroe, making sure that he gets stronger. Everything's all right. We want to pray for those that are sick in our community, those that are still going to get testing, those that are in between testing. That's a tough situation that I get to talk to a lot of people. That's a difficult situation when you've had a test and you're waiting to hear what that result is. A very confusing, very stressful situation. We want to remember those on the front lines. All of our doctors and our nurses and our scientists coming up with a vaccine, those riding in the ambulances. We want to pray for our policemen and our firemen, those that are still having to work when it's hard to social distance because they got to get out and do it. The pastor mentioned to let's remember those who are dealing with death, because we had a lot of funerals here in the past week or two. We want to remember Miss Mary Jane Bryant and her family. We want to remember Miss Bonnie, her family, just other families, Tristan and his family. Just a lot going on, and we do want to pray for our teachers and our administrators that are standing outside of their vehicles, in their vehicles, that They're very stressed. This is a difficult situation to try to teach. We all love the children tremendously, and we want what's best for the children, but it's hard to give them our best in this format. So a lot of teachers, principals, and board members, a lot of those working at the board are just stressed. So we want to pray. Pray for good internet. We want to pray for videos to go smooth, to go out to the children. We want to pray for good understanding of the children when they see a video like that. And we want to pray for mamas and daddies and grandmas to jump in there with the educational process as much as they can and help answer that question. And we want to pray for churches to be on the front lines for whatever we can do to help. Mt.Airy is going to be a Wi-Fi site. I'm so excited about that, that families can come here and jump on Wi-Fi by LREMC and be able to get their education going and whatever other ideas we can do. That's us. That's what we do. We want to celebrate, and we want to be there for everybody, all right? So one thing you can do, if you're not a teacher, if you're not making videos for children to learn what can I do, you can pray for our school year this year. You can pray for children. You can support them, encourage them. Anytime you come across a young person, let them know. I know it's tough. I know you're missing out on some things, but you can do this, and the Lord loves you. If you'll bow your head, we'll pray. Dear Lord, we love you and thank you for your sweet spirit on Back to School Sunday. Holy Father, we are so grateful for those who are here at Mt.Airy, who are educators and giving their hearts and their souls to our children, Lord. Those at home on Facebook and who are giving their time, Holy Father. We pray that you will give them safety. We pray that you will take away the stress, Holy Father. Smooth this, Lord, as they transition into an alternate way of teaching, Lord. Still give them connections with the children. And give them encouragement, Lord, that their lessons are still working and that children are learning, Holy Father, even though this is a unique format, Lord Jesus Christ. They're stressed, Holy Father, and I pray that you'll touch them and their families, Lord, because families of educators see that stress and deal with that stress, Lord Jesus, and be with those families too. Lord Jesus, you saw hands that went up all across the parking lot. You saw horns that were blown, Lord, for special requests. Intervene, Holy Father, in those requests, Holy Father. Touch, Lord Jesus, those that are sick and afflicted, those that are questioning, Lord, those that are in between tests, God. Remember all the requests that were made, Holy Father. And we pray for the children once again, God, that you will just encourage them, that you will give them motivation, Lord Jesus, that they'll be successful. We want this generation to learn and to be educated, Lord. And we are so thankful that you are a personal God today. Touch us the remainder of this service. The pastor's getting ready to preach. We are excited for the word today, Lord. Help us to be comfortable sitting in the seats of our vehicles. Help us to be focused when it's easier to have a side conversation. Help us, Lord Jesus, to look into that word, to hear preaching, Holy Father, and to leave this place better than we came, Lord. We know you're here. If we're the same when we leave, it's not as a fault of yours, Holy Father. It's a fault of ours. So, Lord Jesus, help us focus. Draw us closer to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a honk of praise. Amen.
Amen. I thought we had another song coming up. That's all right. Amen. Are y'all glad to be here this morning? Amen. I tell you, beautiful weather. It's not too hot this morning. I'm not sweating, so that might be a sign. I preached 45 minutes to an hour and 3 minutes. I probably just lost some of you that quick, but we're just thankful to be here today. Couple things I wanted to share with you before we get into the message. Brother Adrian actually hit on it earlier with Brother Kent. It was just a joyful time last night. By the time I got there, he was already rejoicing. The Lord has already doing his work, just rededicating his life to the Lord. He is still a sick man, so let's just continue to keep him in our prayers. Brother Earl, let's remember him in our prayers. I know we do have so much to pray about. I don't know how you're coping with all of this the last several months. I know for some of us it's difficult, especially our seniors, not having the freedom to get out and to go the way they're used to or are used to. And so I can understand the frustration with it. But you know, one of the things I've found is the greatest way to deal with any of it, any of the anxiety, the stress, any of it, is simply the Word of God.
Yeah.
This is our strength right here. And I find myself weak when I don't study and read like I should, or give time because I'm either at work or doing other things. And so I'm looking forward to spending more time in the Word as retirement is soon approaching. Looking forward to that. And also being able to just devote more time to the church. If you have your Bibles, would you turn with us to James chapter 1? And we will be preaching the next two Sundays, or today and next Sunday. I'll be speaking this Sunday and the following Sunday. So if you want to read in the book of James and stay with us on these chapters as we're doing an expository sermon series through this book. And again, the book of James is the practical application. It's all practical, rather. There's no theology. It's just the how-to book on living the Christian life. And I tell you what, you'll find yourself in it. I find myself in my shortcomings as I get into the Word and study it. As a matter of fact, the more you study God's Word, the sinful you should see yourself. Because the holier He gets, and the more sinful we become. That's what the Word does. The Word cuts us. The Word convicts us. It reveals to us what we are. But thank God it doesn't leave us there. It tells us about the solution. And that solution is the Lord Jesus Christ. So again, if you have your Bibles, chapter 1, and give me just a moment. Get my pages turned. I know the wind's already started. James chapter 1. Amen. James chapter 1. Give us just a minute to get set up here. Some of you check your headlights. I see a couple cars with your headlights on. I don't want you to have to get a jump before you leave here today. So if you have, check your headlights. I see a few cars. If you're looking around, folks, you see anybody with headlights on their vehicle, sort of be courteous and just let them know that their headlights are on. They can shut those on. Shut those off. James chapter 1. How many of you have been with us through this series so far? Amen. I hope and pray that it's been a blessing to you. Again, it convicts. It convicts me. And this message today has convicted me more than probably any message so far in this series. As we look at being hearers of the Word, and not just hearers only, but doers. So again, James chapter 1. Starting in verse 19, and I know we've already preached on verses 19 through 21, but we're going to again read those because we have to keep it together in order to understand as we do a little bit of background. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. And here's where we'll begin today in our message, verse 22. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in the glass. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty. And what is that perfect law of liberty? Simply the word of God. And continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. If any man among you seem to be religious, and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. May we pray again. Father, we just thank you again for your word.
Yeah.
Thank you for this beautiful day you've given us, Lord. God, you have blessed us ever since we've started these outdoor services to be able to continue every Sunday. There's been the threat of bad weather. There's been the threat of rain. And even when we've had rain, Lord, for some reason, when things got started, or worship service started, the rain had ceased.
That's right.
You are a good God this morning, and we thank you. And God, regardless of whether it does rain or not, you still give us other means of getting the message out, whether it's through Facebook, whether it's through live video. God, there are other ways that the word can be taught and preached. So man stands without excuse this morning, especially here in the great United States of America. We have every opportunity to hear what thus saith the word of God. The question is whether we're going to be hearers or doers. And Father, we just come before you this morning on behalf of Mt.Airy Church to thank you, Lord, for your blessings upon us. Thank you, Father, again for each and every member that's here, each and every household. We thank you for our visitors who have come today. I look out and I see some visitors among us, and Lord, we're just appreciative of them.
Yeah.
And God, I pray, Father, Lord, that you forgive us of every sin that we've committed. Forgive us of our shortcomings, Lord, our failures. And most importantly, Lord, help us to love one another and to forgive one another as well. We ask you, Lord, to bless these next few moments. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Again, this is part two of our message from James chapter 1 on actually listening and doing. Listening and doing. We all know that the character of man, if we think about it, is determined by our conduct. Would you agree with that? It is determined by our conduct. And scriptural test, if you will, of true religion is conduct. It's behavior. It's attitude. It's right living. It's how we conduct ourselves. And no wonder Ephesians on one occasion, you know, tells us to be careful how we are to behave, how we are to walk, how we are to live there in chapter 4, as we're talking about behavior. And then one of the things about it, it's an infallible test because the heart of every person governs their behavior. Did you know that? The heart of every man governs that. See, Jesus taught us that a good tree does what? It produces what? Good fruit. A bad tree produces corrupt fruit. Sweet fountain brings forth sweet water, and bitter fountain brings forth bitter water. You say, well, how is this so? Because again, Matthew chapter 12, one of the things we learned there is that the Bible says, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. What comes out of the heart or out of the mouth is again, what's inside the heart. And so again, our speech, folks, needs to be seasoned with grace. It needs to be the right. We need to have the right temperament. We need to have the right attitude. Because again, the character of a man is determined by his conduct. And so the matter of conduct is really the test for our genuine faith. Somebody might ask the question, well, who are the friends of Christ? Who is a friend of Christ? And the answer would come from John chapter 15, verse 14. It says, you are my friends if you do whatever I command you. If you do whatever I command you. Others might say, well, who are those who really love the Lord Jesus Christ? And you might ask yourself that question. Do I love the Lord? Do I love him? We can ask that question, yes. I think I ask myself that question quite a bit. Do I really love the Lord? Do I really cherish him? Do I really do what he asked me to do? And again, we find the answer in John chapter 14 again. He says, he that loveth me, what? Keeps my commandments. Somebody else might come along and say, well, how does one know that he even possesses the life of God? How do we know that Christ is living on the inside of us? How do we know this? John again, chapter 2, verse 3. Hereby do we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Now, I know we're not saved by the law. I understand that. Don't get me mixed up here. But again, when we're talking about keeping his commandments, what is the greatest of the commandments? What? Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. The question we have to ask ourselves is, are we loving God? Are we loving our neighbor? And again, it will reflect in the way or in our conduct. Folks will know whether it's true or not by the way we live, by the way we treat people, our attitude, right living, right character. And folks, that's so important in this time that we're living in because the world is looking for an answer. And they're not going to find it on Facebook. They're not going to find it on social media. I'm not saying that we can't use that. But what they're really going to find it is when they look at our lives and see how we live. They're going to watch us. And how do we do this? By responding to the word in the right way. There's the reception of the word and there's a response to the word. We've been talking about that. How do we respond? We talked the other week about receiving the word with submission. To receive it in purity. To receive it in humility. See, we receive the word, but then there's our responsibility to respond to the word. It's one thing to receive it, to hear it, but now we are to apply it. We are to live it out in our Christian life every day. See, I can hear the word all day long, but if I don't respond to it, if I don't put it into action, you see, the Bible says even the devils believe. Even the demons believe. But it's more than just believing. It's more than just hearing. We have to apply what we hear. We have to apply what we learn. We have to respond to the word. So the question would be then, how do we respond to his word? We respond by practicing what it teaches. It's not enough to hear it. We must do it. We must practice it. We must live it. We must be obedient to it. This is why this message has convicted me this week, because I see my shortcomings when it comes to being an obedient servant all the time. And obedience is better than what? It's better than sacrifice. So application. You know, one of the things we said last week about being a hearer, or a week before last, if you remember, we said that the word hearer, here in the Greek, is the word auditor. And what is an auditor? An auditor is someone who actually takes a class, but they don't sign up to get accreditation or credits for that class. They're just there to observe, and that's it. They're just there to hear. And when I was at Carolina Bible College, we had several folks that did that. They were older, seniors, some of them retired. They just wanted to listen in the classroom. They didn't want to take any tests. They didn't want to get any grade. They didn't want a grade. They didn't want any credits. They just wanted to observe. They wanted to hear. Well, that's great on one aspect, but when it comes to being a Christian and living the Christian life, we can't just be auditors. We can't just hear. We got to be doers. Why? Because verse 22 says, "But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves." You know what the word or the phrase "be ye doers" here means? It means to be continually doing, keeping on striving to be the doers of God's word.
Yeah.
Now, the Jewish rabbis taught this. So when James was writing this, they could identify with this because the Jews taught it all the time. Unfortunately, though, for the Jews, they thought that their salvation was based on their works. They thought that they were saved because of their doing, or because of their activity, so forth. But that's not really what he's saying here. We are to be believers and we're to be doers, but of course we know that there has to be the application of salvation through faith in Christ. We understand that. But so the Jewish rabbis would have been teaching this. And you say, well, do true believers put the word into practice? Do we put it into practice? Yes, we do. Do we put it into practice all the time? No, we don't. This is the convicting part for me. Well, if I'm not doing it all the time, then here's the question. If I'm not doing it all the time, the question is, what am I doing about it? That's where you begin to see whether or not you're truly saved, is when you are convicted by things, when it does bother you that you're not where you need to be, when it does bother you that you know you could be doing better, and you're striving to do the best you can. You see, we're not saved because of our perfection. We understand that. But it's a good indication you are saved when you acknowledge your imperfections. When you acknowledge the fact that you're doing the best you can, but there's always room for more. As a matter of fact, if all of us were doing what we're supposed to be doing, then guess what? My pastoral duties would be relatively simple, wouldn't they?
Right.
I wouldn't have a lot to do. But you know, as a pastor, it's my responsibility to preach and teach the word of God, to make disciples out of the church. Someone once asked me before, said, "Preacher, how come you don't preach to sinners that often?" Well, I'm a pastor. I'm not an evangelist. My job as a pastor is to evangelize, not evangelize, but to again teach the church, to help the church to grow, to make disciples. And we are to send folks out and to win lost people to Christ. As a shepherd, that's what we do, is feed the sheep. And the sheep give birth to sheep.
Right.
Now, he says here, if we're not doers of the word, if we're just auditors, if I'm just listening and that's all I'm doing, if I'm coming to church on Sunday and I hear the pastor, but I'm not applying it whatsoever, I'm not a doer through the week, then you know what he says? He said, you're deceiving your own self. Notice this. What does James mean here when he says I'm deceiving? If you come here and you hear and nothing changes in your life, and you think yourself to be religious, and you think yourself to trust God and have saving faith, then you're deceiving yourself. Because the test of living, saving faith is a willingness to receive the word and apply it. Now, when he uses the word being the deceiver here, or deceiving yourself, it is really a mathematical word. And the mathematical use of this word means this. It means to miscalculate. So in other words, if you just think hearing is enough and not applying it, then we make a gross miscalculation. So the next thing is examination. If we're looking and we're not responding, let's examine something here for just a moment. I want you to let's look at something here for just a minute. If we're going to examine our life, let's look at verse 23. The Bible says in verse 23, if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man beholding himself or his natural face in the glass, for he beholdeth himself and goeth his way and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. James is giving us an analogy here. Stay with me, please. This is important. He says, beholding. He's using an analogy. It means to look carefully, to observe carefully. And it's a forceful word. It is a forceful word in the Greek. It doesn't mean to take a casual glance. It means that you're taking a careful look at yourself. But then look at the next part of that. But he says, but he goeth away and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. In other words, he forgets what he saw. James is saying here, hey, if you're going to look into the word, but then you turn, or the mirror, and you turn around, and as soon as you turn around and walk away, you forget what you look like, then again, we have to ask ourselves, are we genuinely saved? Are we where we're supposed to be? Now, I'll ask you a question, ladies, when it comes to this part. How many of you, at times, you look in the mirror, and you get distracted, forget something, you go to work, got some lipstick on your teeth, maybe you forgot an eyelash, forgot an earring, or maybe some of you men, you get to work and realize you missed some places shaving, or you combed your hair and missed that bald spot, and you put your hair on the wrong side of the head, and it should have been on the other side of the head, because we forgot what we looked like when we got out of that mirror. Or maybe we didn't tie our tie just right, or your zipper was down and you didn't pay attention to it. These are all examples of how easy we can overlook some things in our life. Is that not true?
Yeah, that's true.
Some don't look into the word. Some of us don't look into the mirror because we're afraid of what we might see. Some of us don't look into the mirror because we don't have the time. We're in a rush. We're in a hurry. Or maybe some of us don't look into the mirror because we feel like we're okay the way we are. Man, I look good this morning. I don't need to check myself. I don't need to go look in the mirror. I'm all right. I do this same routine every day. But your attitude when it comes to hearing the word of God might be the key to something. As a matter of fact, it's going to be key to everything. You can't just glance in the mirror of God's word. You got to continually look into it. And here's the thing. When you look into the word, do you ask God to show you yourself in his word? You ever looked in that mirror so close and you see all these little imperfections in your face? The older I get, the more I see it. My wife is constantly telling me, Kelvin, you need to take care of your skin. You're going to start having wrinkles. And I'm sitting there thinking, I'm 50 years old. I don't care whether I got wrinkles or not. But women are getting more self-conscious of those kind of things. They're more aware of it than we are as men, are they not? And so I see my wife all the time in the mirror. She's always looking at herself. I walk in there. She's got even those mirrors with the lights around them, brother. Yep. Brother Asian. I've looked at it before just to be curious. I'm like, God, I didn't know I had that many blackheads. Or I didn't know I had this. I didn't know I had that. You know, we look at it as men. We don't really think that much of it. But for a woman, it is imperative that she checks herself constantly before she goes out and goes to work. And even in the mirror on the patrol, when I'm in the patrol car and I'm behind somebody at the light, and it's a lady, maybe she's running late for work. She's brushing her hair. She's checking her. She's putting her lipstick on. She's fixing her face. Even going down the road. So we again see how important it is for some ladies when it comes to that mirror. Well, you know what? As Christians, we need to be the same way.
Yeah.
You know, we need to be the same way. Somebody might say, well, get on, hurry up and go through the lights. You can check your hair when you get to work. I wish we were that way when it comes to the Word of God. All of us, checking ourselves. When we get into the car, we turn it on the gospel channel. We're listening to the Word of God. I love going to work and listening to different preachers sometimes when I'm at work. Because again, saturating ourselves with the Word of God calls us to do something. We'll get into it in just a second. So ladies, men, we examine ourselves. Get back to the question I just asked you. Do you ask God to show you yourself when you look into the Word? Do you ask God to show you all the imperfections? Do you have a humble spirit when you approach the Word of God? Or do you say to yourself, man, I hope the preacher's short-winded today. God, I got things to do. I wish you'd hurry up. You know, I don't have time to stand here and look in the mirror this long. You know, preacher, 35 minutes is ample time for me to look into the Word this morning. You know I got some imperfections, but I can work on them later. You know, that's what we need to do, though, is look in the Word constantly.
Amen.
Let me give you some examples of men, patriarchs, who looked into the Word carefully, who examined themselves carefully. I want you to see what they had to say. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 5, he says, woe is me, for I am undone. Who was this? This was a man who saw himself. Here was on Luke over in chapter 5, verse 8. He says, well, this was Peter, actually, but it's in Luke's gospel. Peter cried out and said, depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord. Job over in chapter 42 and verse 6, and even though he was the most righteous man on earth at that time and in his day, yet he confessed something. What did he confess? He said, I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. Well, what are these examples of? These are examples of men who looked carefully into the Word of God or had an encounter with the Lord, a close encounter. And when you, if you go back and think about when you got saved, do you remember when you got saved? Do you remember conviction? Do you remember being broken? Why? Because you saw yourself. That's exactly what took place. Now, he, the Holy Spirit, is the one that came and brought that conviction into your heart and caused you to see yourself for who you are. But once you saw yourself for who you are, the sinfulness and the brokenness and the contrite spirit, then God could work.
Yeah.
Same thing applies to us as Christians today. Are we broken over sin? Are we broken when we don't spend time with God? Are we not convicted when we spend more time doing other things other than looking into His Word? Man, this touched me. This convicts me. Because again, I see my imperfections. But here's the answer. Here's the restoration. Look at verse 25. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deeds. Now here's the contrast. One verse says look, or behold, rather, but then the other one says looketh. The word behold in the Greek, we talked about it earlier, we just in the previous verse, it means to take a careful look, does it not?
Yeah.
But here he says, he doesn't say behold, but whosoever beholdeth, he says looketh into the perfect law of liberty. Now what does this mean? Here he's meaning that it's a person who really gets into it and really searches it out. He's the stooping that implies even a humbling of oneself. In other words, looking intently with great desire and effect at the mirror, wanting to discern what is revealed. I mean, you're stooping over and you're looking into it carefully. That's what getting into the Word of God will do.
Amen.
And you look into it so intently that you begin to see all those imperfections. You begin to see all of the flaws. Because until we see that, we can't do anything about it. It's only until we're convicted by it and broken by it. But he says that we're looking into the perfect law of liberty. What does this mean? Simply the Word of God. And let me say to you that because there is grace for sin, that does not mean there's no law. Listen, we still have law. But he says the perfect law of liberty. What is this law he's talking about? The law of freedom. The law of liberty. God has given us the law. He's given us freedom. The freedom. And that simply means that you and I now, because we've been saved, we've been given this freedom to live our Christian life. But it's not a license to sin. We still need to be convicted when we're wrong. We still need to be convicted when things are not right in our life. And because there's forgiveness, when we break it, doesn't mean there's no law. There is a moral law that God wants us to obey. And Jesus came to fulfill that law, not to set it aside. He says in Matthew chapter 17, all the way to verse 20, chapter 20, it's a perfect law, it's complete, it's sufficient, but it is the law of liberty. Look at what he says here, that he continueth therein. That's the key. It means that he looks, he keeps on looking, wanting to learn more about God and His Son. Wanting the Word to reveal our sins so that Christ can cleanse us from them. Folks, when we spend time in the Word of God, when we really look into the law of liberty and continue therein, you will not have time to find everybody else's imperfections. You won't have time to look at everybody else's flaws. You won't have time to see everyone else's imperfections because when you spend time in the Word of God yourself, all you'll have time to do is work on you.
Amen.
And boy, I tell you what, Facebook is the worst. We beat each other up. We put each other down on Facebook as if we got all the answers.
Right.
Folks, no, God is the answer. Man doesn't have the answer. God is the answer. He says that we continueth therein. We're continuing therein. He sees all that is wrong in his life and all that is unpleasing to God, and he wants to throw it off. He wants to get rid of it. That's the kind of character that makes or is a mark of a true believer. there's a perfect example. He said, well, preacher, I'm already saved. Yeah, I know you're saved. Well, I don't need to get saved again. That's not what I'm talking about. But every once in a while, you need a bath. Every once in a while, you need to be washed. Jesus told Peter that on one occasion. If you recall, he said, you don't need to be. In other words, I'm paraphrasing here. There's no, you don't have to go get saved again, Peter. That's not. But every once in a while, your feet's going to get dirty.
Yeah.
You see, the priest was an example of this with Aaron and his sons over in Exodus chapter 30. Between the tabernacle and the congregation, or the altar rather, the tabernacle and the altar, there was this brazen laver, or polished bronze laver. And what that was, it had water in it. And those priests, before they went into the altar, they would go there, they had one for the hand and they had one for the feet. And they would wash themselves, the Bible said, lest they die. Now, these were the high priest of God, the priest of God. But yet, this is symbolic, folks, of you and I being saved, being God's people, but yet still needing to wash every once in a while. Because that bronze laver represents the word. The water in that bronze laver represents the word. And we constantly need to wash ourselves, to bathe ourselves in God's word. Don't have to get saved again. But what you do need to do occasionally is get into the word of God and get a spiritual bath. Because we get contaminated every week. Every day in this world we live in. And then we want to know why young people are so prone to failure and sin in the time we're living in. Look at the temptation all around them. And if they're not saved, what kind of fight do they have? What kind of ability do they have to keep themselves from being unspotted, the Bible says, if they don't even know Christ in the first place? But even if they do know Christ, and all they ever get is just Sunday school occasionally, you're not going to have the strength to fight, folks. You're going to be beat down all the time in this world we live in. And so he says here, not just to be hearers of the word, but to be doers of the word. And let's look at something else here in verse 26 when it comes to sharing the word of God. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridles not his tongue. Now we're going to get into the true part of it here that I want to bring up. It bridled not his tongue, but deceives his own heart. This man's religion is useless. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction and keep oneself unspotted from the world. You know what the word seem here means? It says, if any man among you seem, that could be translated, has the opinion of himself that he's religious or thinks himself to be religious. The average person out there will tell you they are religious. The average person will say, well, I go to such and such church. How many times have I asked people, I say, are you saved? Well, I go to such and such church. Are you saved? Well, I've been going there for 25 years.
Yeah.
Or I say, are you saved? Well, I got baptized when I was 12. They're very religious, but they're avoiding the question. The question is, have you ever had an encounter with Christ? Do you know what it is to have a personal, intimate relationship with him? Have you come by the way of the cross? Have you come through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Now, he says, if any man seem to be religious and bridles not his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is in vain. Now, give me a second. I'm going to break these verses down, and we're going to move on.
All right.
The word religious, thraskos in the Greek, it is an objective form, and it has to do with ceremonial public worship. It has to do with the outward ceremony. And the Pharisees were big on this. They were the example of the outward religious folks. That's why Jesus said on one occasion, he said, the outside of your cup is clean, but the inside is full of dead men's bones. In other words, you have an outward appearance of religion. He said, but you've never been saved. You've never been regenerated. You've never come to know Christ. And so they were outward religious. And here's the thing. They were had outward religion without manifest inner control. And it reveals that the religion is useless. Because professing religion and having a tongue out of control is a great deception. You can profess to know God, but if your tongue, your mouth, your attitude reflects something different, chances are you haven't been saved. You can't tell me you're saved if you've got a nasty disposition, if you are constantly vulgar, if your mouth is constantly full of a vicious poison.
That's right.
Something's wrong. something's not right. Why is this? Because James speaks of the tongue. Out of the abundance of the heart, we said in Matthew, what? The mouth speaks. In other words, your lips will reveal what's really in your heart. And so when he says that true religion here, but if our tongue is not right, if our mouth is not right, James is speaking here to the church who was being persecuted. And this is important because when persecution comes, we're tempted to do something. We're tempted to get upset. We're tempted to get angry. We're tempted to fight back. But true religion won't fight back.
Right.
True religion will do what? Be submissive to God and let God fight your battles. Some of us here today need to quit trying to fight the world's battles and let God fight them. Some of us here today need to quit trying to figure out all the social ills in the world and give it to God. God is the solution. Stop trying to fix everything on your own because you can't. Only God can. Only God can do that. Pure religion, that which is clean, pure of heart. It's not through word only, but through our deeds that reveal the true heart. But look at what he says here. I like this part. It says, before God. Let me go back to that verse. It says in verse 26, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this. Now let's look at that little phrase, before God. Pure religion and undefiled before whom? Before who? Before God. See, God is the one that evaluates. Pure religion by God's standards, he's the one that evaluates. The genuineness of anybody's religion is not determined by their own opinion. It's determined by the opinion of God. So you and I can't sit back and claim that we know everything or claim that everything's right without God's opinion. God's opinion is the one that matters. It says pure religion and undefiled before God. God says you are genuine religious in the true sense of the word. When your life is what? Marked by obedience. When your life is marked by obedience. When your life is marked by love. When we are obedient to God's word. When we love one another. And that's demonstrated in our actions. That is the true indication of pure religion. Because he uses the next word. And I'm coming to a close here. When you visit the fatherless and the widows. I want you to catch something here. See, we think that visiting means I just ride by and see how y'all doing. It's not what visiting means here. It means more than just going by to see how you're doing. It carries the idea of bringing love and bringing pity to someone. You see, the fatherless and the widows in their affliction, if you go back to the Old Testament, God has always been concerned with the fatherless and the widows. In the book of Exodus, chapter 22, he says, "You shall not afflict any widow or fatherless child." Deuteronomy chapter 14, every third year, they demanded a special tithe to be collected from every Jew to take care of for the all orphans and the widows. Deuteronomy chapter 24, verses 17 all the way to 22. There was this sort of a profit sharing, if you will. This profit sharing of for orphans and widows to be cared for in the harvesting of the fields. You remember in the book of Ruth? You remember when Ruth and Naomi came back home? What did they leave in the corners of those fields? They left them empty for the gleaners. For the widows, the orphans. You didn't gather that in the corners of the fields that were left. That was the welfare system back then. But I love that welfare system because you got out and worked for it. They didn't just give it to you.
That's right.
You didn't go by and had it in a sack waiting on you to come by and pick it up. No, you had to get out there and actually pick it up.
Amen.
And so that was the welfare system at that time, but it was guaranteed for the widows and the orphans. Then it was Deuteronomy chapter 27. God demanded justice for the widow and justice for the orphans. Why? If they were mistreated. Why? Because in Psalm 68 verse 5, listen to this. God is a father of the fatherless and the judge of the widows. God has a special heart for people who have great need, and widows and orphans fall into that category. Now, fixing to burst our bubble here for just a moment. We're talking about true religion. He's talking about whether or not we are approved of God. How we treat one another. How we treat orphans and widows. And the reason James uses this is because he knew how passionate God was toward widows and orphans. This is just one example. This is not the ultimate example, but one of many examples as to whether or not our religion is true. And one of them was how you treat orphans and widows.
That's right.
1 Timothy chapter 5, this is where all of us are responsible. Speaks of the responsibility of the church when it comes to taking care of true widows. Now, when I say true widows, we're talking about those that had no children, they had lost their husband, they had no children, they had no outside resources. They were true widows. Naomi, Ruth, she was a true widow. She had no sons. She had two daughters-in-law, and that was it. But see, they, at that time, they couldn't possess anything. You had to have a man had to be in the home in order to get the inheritance, what was left. And so that's why Boaz, of course, redeems, buys Naomi, I'm getting confused here for a second, Ruth, and restores everything that had belonged to the husbands.
Right.
And so these true widows are the ones that the church is responsible for. 1 John chapter 4, listen to this. Beloved, let us love one another, for the love of is God, and everyone that loves is born of God and knoweth God. And he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. So how are we treating each other? How do we treat true widows? How do we treat the fatherless? How do we treat our neighbors? It's imperative here, folks. If our religion is genuinely true, then how are we treating people around us? Man, this is convicting. This is causing me to see where I need to be as a Christian. That there's more I need to be doing. I'm not saved by my works, but you know what? Genuine faith produces good works. It does. And lastly, he said, keep yourself unspotted from the world. The word, their world, cosmos, means the system. This is going to get us right here. The system, the culture, the lifestyle around us, the stuff of the world, its philosophy, its morality, its ethics, or lack of them, is what that's referring to. How do we align ourselves with those around us? How do we align ourselves with the social system? How do we align ourselves with the philosophy of others? How do we align ourselves when it comes to how we, just our everyday walk? How do we align ourselves with other people around us? It's not to mean that you'll be better than they are, but there needs to be a fine line. We need to draw the line and be careful that we don't align ourselves with the lifestyle of others, the culture around us, because it can influence you. It's like putting a good apple, one bad apple in a barrel. You know the old story? That it contaminates the rest, right? We have to be careful that we don't get ourselves in a position to be spotted, that we are to be unspotted from the world. To keep yourself in a present tense here is what it means, in the present tense form, which continually is the word here, continually unspotted. James is saying that pure religion belongs to people who show an inner control. Manifest in their speech and their attitude is what he's saying. You show love for people in need. You stay away from those that's being stained by the culture, buying into this satanic philosophy. That's how Christians are to live. We're to live this way. So it's okay if people shun you because of your Christian values. You know what? You ought to take that as a compliment. Take that as a compliment when somebody says, well, I don't want to be around so-and-so because they're a Christian. Man, that should be a good compliment.
Amen.
Now, they shouldn't say, well, I don't want to be around so-and-so because they say they're a Christian, but they don't live it. No, they should be saying, I don't want to be around them because they're convicted by it. When they don't want to offend you, or they're afraid of saying something that might be offensive and being convicted by it, that's a good thing. It really is. In closing, the question we have to ask ourselves again, how am I responding to God's word? Am I a hearer and a doer, or am I just a hearer only? Folks, you're the only one that can answer that.
That's right.
I'm the only one that can answer for myself. I can't answer for anybody else. I hope and pray this message has convicted you in some form or fashion, because it sure has me. It showed me my shortcomings, that I need to be doing much more in my Christian life for my neighbor, for those outside, because there are folks all around us, people that are dying every day without Christ. There are folks that are dying all around us that don't know the Lord. Look at the young people that are dying every day around us, murdered, drug overdoses. I mean, it's so sad. Children without fathers, children without mothers. If you're here today and you've got both parents, you're blessed. If you're here today and you've got a church family that prays for you, you're blessed. If you're here today and you got loved ones that are concerned about you, then you are blessed. There are so many that don't have that this morning. That's what I shared last night with Brother Earl. As we were there around Brother Kent, and we were praying with him, and we got through praying, and I was just telling Brother Earl, I said, ain't it wonderful? Looking around at all of the family here with him. I said, and y'all are saved, and you can pray with him and talk to him. I said, do you know how many families that would be in the same situation and not a soul saved? Not a single person in that room being saved. It happens. It happens. Would you bow your heads? Father, we come to you, Lord, this morning recognizing that we need to be doers of your word. I'm convicted in the sense, Father, that I need to be closer, that I need to guard my lips, as the psalmist said, that no evil thing shall come out of my mouth. That I behold, I put no evil thing before my eyes. We need to be careful what we see, what we listen to. We need to be careful what we say.
Yeah.
We need to be careful of our actions, Lord, that we don't offend anyone. That we don't take our liberties, dear Father, Lord, and use them to offend someone else who might be of an immature state at the time. And even though we have liberties, dear God, we have to be careful with those liberties. That we don't offend anyone, especially a young convert. Forgive us, Lord, of our shortcomings. Help us, Lord, to live a more productive Christian life.
Right.
Thank you for Mt.Airy Baptist Church, Lord, this morning. Thank you for people here that love the Lord. People here that give. People that show compassion. People that are not afraid to stand up for the vulnerable. Stand up for those who are less fortunate. To stand up for those who are taking advantage of, God. We just thank you, Lord, for people here that love you. We ask you, Lord, to bless the remainder of this day. Be with us, lead us, and guide us, and direct us. And Lord, as we come back next Sunday and we look at the message of partiality in the church, of showing favoritism, God, help us to be mindful, dear Father, of that message also. And Father, Lord, if there's anyone here under the sound of our voice who's never accepted you as a personal Savior, God, today's the day of salvation, dear Father. Tomorrow's not promised. You could take us out of here today. And Lord, I believe the time is winding up. We don't have a lot of time left. According to world events, the things that are taking place around us. Help our church folks, Lord, not to be deceived by what's going on with the world system. To not get caught up in the deception of what is taking place around us through the system of the world. God, there's no answer in man. There's no answer in politics. There's no answer in the social climate. Lord, it only comes from you. You are the one, God, who provides all the resources that we need, that sustains us and keeps us. Bless us, Lord, the rest of this day, God, and we'll give you glory and honor for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. I think the hunters will sing us a song now, an invitation song. And if you're unsaved today, listen, as he sings this song in our closing, if you're not saved, make your way up here today. You say, well, preacher, I don't want to come before everybody. I'll talk to you over there in the corner if that's what you want. But if you want to be saved, today's the day of salvation. Come, sing for us, honey. Something else this morning. Is Sister Kel, she's still here? Is she still here? Hey, amen. There she comes. Hey, amen. I want her to come. I'm going to ask a couple of deacons to join Brother Adrian up here at the front. And I'm going to ask Sister Misha, Sister Melanie, Sister Cynthia. Come on, let's sing. We'll just go sing one. Caught him off guard, but that's all right. Bible said to be prepared. Amen. I think I got the words here. Amen. We'll go sing one, and I'm going to ask these brothers if they would just be up here for anyone that maybe has a prayer, that really wants to be prayed for this morning. You've got a sincere prayer concern. They're going to be right over here to our left. I'm going to ask them if they would. And maybe there's a couple that might want to be on this side. And we're going to sing. And as we're singing, if you just feel a need to come pray, I know it's social distancing. I understand that. We'll be as careful as possible. If you don't want to get too close, you just want to come up and stand close to them and just share your concerns or just share whatever it is you're going through or just say, hey, I just need prayer. Do that as we sing this song.
How great is our God.
Sovereign. He's still in control. He's a loving Savior. He cares about you. None of this caught him off guard. He's not fooled. He's not surprised. He knows every bit of it. It's all been planned out from the beginning, before the foundations of the world, that Christ, even Christ, would come. So we are going to trust him. That's what we're doing. We're trusting him. You know, the enemy wants us to sit back and think that everything's out of control, that somehow he wants you to doubt. That's what he wants you to do. He wants you to doubt God's provision, his providence, his sovereignty. But this is the test right now we're going through. This is the point where you say, you know what, I'm going to trust God. Whether the pandemic wipes half of us out, whether I don't have a job, whether I don't have any food, I'm going to trust God. You know why? Because God will provide for you. He'll take care of it. When you're down to your last dollar, I guarantee you, if you'll trust him, you know what he'll do? He'll send a raven by your house. He'll send a neighbor to your house. He'll send somebody to provide for you what you need this morning. Just trust him. That's what he wants you to do, is trust him through all of this. Just trust him. Trust him. Trust him is what he wants us to do. Brother Attic, I want you to close us in prayer. I want you to pray, brother, this morning. I feel the power of God in this place today. I feel God's anointing here. Somebody needs to be saved. I tell you, we need to thank him this morning because of his love and his mercy. He's a good God. He loves us so much that he sent his only begotten Son. I tell you, we shouldn't be ashamed of him. We should praise him. We should lift him up high for everybody to know that this man named Jesus, this crucified Savior who hung on the cross, loves me this morning. He died for me this morning. If you don't know him today, today's the day of salvation. Today's the day. You need to come. Brother Addict's going to pray, and this will be our closing prayer. Now, if you leave today and you didn't get what you needed, God's here. You can't blame the Lord. He's here this morning. Come if you need a touch from him this morning. You say, well, preacher, my faith is so weak. You know what? You're at the right place for your faith to be strengthened. You're at the right place for God to move this morning. Brother Harley, no, get out of your truck if you will. Just come up here. I just want you to come up here and stand with these brothers. Brother Alton, where are you at? Brother Alton Higgins, if you're here, I'm not telling y'all to get too close to each other. I just want you to come and stand. And we're just going to pray this morning. Brother Alton's going to pray. I just feel God's presence this morning. I just pray that God just will move today on somebody's life. I don't know what you're going through. Don't know what you experienced this week. You know, we've had a lot of deaths in the last few weeks. It's been a little depression at times, but you know what? God is still sovereign. He's still in control this morning. Amen. Come on. Come on, brothers. Y'all just come up here and stand. We're going to pray. If you want to stand outside your car as we pray, that's fine too. Amen. God bless you. I see somebody else coming this morning. Come on, Sister Macy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Come on, brother.
Hallelujah.
Hey.
Yes, Lord.
Hey.
Hallelujah.
Hey.
Yes, Jesus.
Hey.
Come on.
Hey.
Hallelujah!
Hey!
Thank you,
Let's pray. Our gracious and heavenly Father. Lord, we're so thankful for your Son. We're thankful, Father, that we have the opportunity, Lord, that Jesus gave us when he shed his precious blood on that cross. Because, Lord, you decided one day that the only atonement for sin that you were going to accept was the blood of your Son, Jesus. And, Lord, you loved him in such a way that you were willing to give up your Son so that we might have the right to receive him as our personal Savior, acknowledging him to the world that he's the only answer for sin that you're going to accept. Lord, with all this confusion that's going on around us, Lord, we need to be right here on our knees at this time, at this place, having faith and confidence that you have an answer for every problem that exists, every hand that is raised, every person in this parking lot, Lord. The answer is your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, I'm so thankful to be a part of this service and to feel the Spirit the way he's just motivating us this morning to worship you. And Father, I like what the pastor has said this morning. It's not my works that are going to get me in the kingdom, but I need to be able to do kingdom work. And Lord, that kingdom work that you've charged us with is to love everyone that we come in contact with. Like the brother last night that we dedicated his life. What a true soldier that is to that family to know that they're going to be able to see him on the other side when you call us, Lord, or come back to get us as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Father, we're so thankful for this opportunity this morning. We're thankful for this service, Lord. We're thankful for what it means to serve you as the true and living God. Father, we pray that you will go with us, that you'll continue to charge us this week to stand up no matter where we are for your Son Jesus and to love those that we come in contact with. Father, all these things we're going to give you the honor, the praise, and the glory for. For it's in your Son's name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
God bless y'all. Have a wonderful day. Have a wonderful day.